It was in July 1943 that the Russian city of Kursk bore witness to the largest tank battle in history. The outcome of the battle was crucial. It put an end to Hitler's offensive power on the Eastern Front. At Kursk, the Soviet army would draw the German forces into a deliberate battle of attrition, designed to grind down Hitler's last remaining attacking strength in the east. The German staff officers could see the danger, but the Führer was blind to it. On the 10th of May 1943, the architect of Germany's tank forces, General Heinz Guderian, became engaged in a heated conversation with Adolf Hitler regarding Hitler's decision to attack at Kursk. Guderian is reported to have asked, "How many people do you think even know where Kursk is? It is a matter of profound indifference to the world whether we hold Kursk or not. Why do we want to attack in the east at all this year?" To this, Hitler replied, "You're quite right. Whenever I think of this attack, my stomach turns over." Guderian strongly advised Hitler to remain on the defensive, but Hitler was determined. He would go ahead with the attack. Guderian was not alone in his apprehension. Almost to a man, Hitler's generals had advised him to adopt a defensive posture on the Eastern Front during 1943. The last 2 years had cost them dearly, and they needed a chance to rest and regroup. Hitler's decision to attack would seriously damage his forces and remove any hope the Germans had of regaining the initiative in the Eastern Theater. By draining away the German tank strength, the short but intensive Battle of Kursk would tip the scales of World War II decisively in the favor of Soviet Russia. On the 1st of September 1939, Hitler's forces smashed through the Polish frontier. This prompted Britain and France to officially declare war on Germany 2 days later. Hitler hoped to avoid this outcome, as he never expected the Western governments to go to war over Poland. Poland was obliterated in a matter of weeks when Hitler used the Blitzkrieg tactic to gain control of the country. Before Hitler could continue advancing eastwards, he knew he would first have to deal with his enemies in the west. By May 1940, the German troops turned their offensive westwards. The war with the west was drastically different to that with Poland, as the forces facing the Germans were modern and well equipped. However, the British and French armies were still relying on tactics used during the First World War, and were totally unprepared for the superior skills and strategy of the Germans. Within weeks, Hitler took control of Holland, Belgium, Luxembourg, and France. The British managed to escape across the Channel at Dunkirk, but were in no position to fight back. Full of confidence after the great victories of 1939 and 1940, Hitler pushed ahead with his plans to invade Soviet Russia in 1941. He held a deep contempt for the Soviet Union and boasted that we just have to kick in the door and the whole rotten edifice will come crashing down. The gains made during the invasion of Russia in June 1941 confirmed Hitler's optimism, as a disorganized and poorly led Red Army retreated in complete confusion. However, the first winter in Russia gave the German soldiers a sharp taste of what lay in store for them. Battered but unbowed, the German forces just managed to avoid total collapse. For the next 18 months, the front lines seesawed back and forth, as both sides wrestled for control of the towns and cities. The southern region in particular saw some of the biggest and most damaging battles for both sides. Ferocious battles for Sevastopol, Kiev, Rostov, and Stalingrad consumed vast amounts of men and materials as control of the towns and cities swayed from side to side. In February 1943, the total defeat at Stalingrad was a disaster for the Germans. But a switch to the strategic defensive might just have brought enough time to regain the initiative in 1944. But Hitler was adamant. He would attack. By mid-1943, the focus of attention would once more be in the south of Russia, where the Germans were to make one more attempt to gain the decisive edge. This was to be the last great gamble in the East, a high noon for Hitler and his hopes for victory. Confident after the stunning victories over Poland in 1939 and the Western Allies in 1940, Hitler pushed ahead with his ultimate goal of defeating Soviet Russia in 1941. His generals had advised him to wait, for German forces were not strong enough at this stage of the war. They needed more time to prepare. Hitler instead mounted the biggest land invasion in history. Like his previous campaigns, Hitler expected quick victory, and the mobile warfare tactic was employed once again. By the winter of 1941, however, it was apparent that the war in Russia would be difficult and take far longer than anticipated. The Russians launched a massive counter-offensive during this first winter and almost succeeded in defeating the Germans. Hitler himself issued the order to stand fast and hold the ground already won. The success of this policy convinced Hitler that he knew better than his generals. But when it was repeated, the policy of holding on was to prove disastrous. The crushing defeat of the German Sixth Army at Stalingrad affected Hitler deeply, as it came as a direct result of his refusal to allow a withdrawal. Now he planned the Kursk offensive to regain the initiative and save his reputation. Unlike Hitler, the ruthless dictator of the USSR had no formal military experience. A politician, first and foremost, he was prepared to do almost anything to maintain his position of power. Stalin was responsible for the purges of the Red Army in 1937, which severely hampered their fighting capabilities in the early stages of the German invasion. The loss of so many commanders prevented the Red Army from fighting cohesively. Nevertheless, Stalin knew how to manipulate people and situations to his own advantage. Once the German invasion began, he quickly rallied the population behind him, despite the fact that he had been systematically killing countless numbers of his own people. He played on their love of Mother Russia, and even within the army, he ensured that the power of the political commissars was limited during these crucial early stages. He was astute enough, however, to listen to his generals and took their advice many times. He put the brilliance of commanders like Zhukov and Konev to good use, playing one against the other to ensure maximum results. Quick to take the glory for any successes, and ruthless enough to ensure his troops and people would not dare to question him, he saw his nation through to ultimate victory over the Nazi invaders. By the spring of 1943, the German army and German nation were still in deep shock over the defeat at Stalingrad. This defeat was their first major reverse of the war, and the famed tenacity of the Russian soldier had been decisively proved. The Russian offensive, launched immediately after Stalingrad, presented the very real danger that the German army would be pushed back even further. Fast reactions from von Manstein and the effective use of the fighting capabilities of the German armed forces finally halted the Russian attack. The stunning victory at Kharkov, achieved against the odds, became known as von Manstein's miracle. The desperate men of Army Group South had at last contained the Soviet advance. Further north, Army Group Center had held fast and halted the Russian advances near Orel. In between these two areas, the Soviet advances had created a huge enemy bulge, which held large amounts of Soviet men and materials. In the middle of the bulge lay the town of Kursk. Keen to capitalize on the victory at Kharkov, Hitler wanted to regain the initiative in the east. Von Manstein drew up a plan that provided for a similar action to Kharkov, where the German army had first given up ground and had then quickly counterattacked when the Russian lines of supply became overstretched. Characteristically, Hitler rejected the withdrawal phase of the plan, but approved the attacks towards Kursk. This part of the plan was developed by Colonel General Zeitzler, who gave it the final draft, codenamed Zitadelle. The plan was to advance from the north and south towards Kursk and trap the Soviets in a huge pocket. This pocket could then be systematically destroyed. To make the plan work, however, the attack would have to be launched quickly before the Russians had time to prepare defenses. The initial plan had May as the start date, but various delays forced the start date back to July, by which time the Russians had prepared defensive positions that would present the Germans with formidable obstacles. The Russian victory at Stalingrad had shown that the mighty German army could be defeated. The seemingly endless resources of Russia in both men and machines could and would be sacrificed to ensure the ultimate goal was achieved. The Russian offensive launched after Stalingrad had been intended to build on the recent successes, but what was not expected was the ability of the German soldier to recover quickly. The Russians suffered a surprise defeat at Kharkov in March 1943, just 1 month after the surrender at Stalingrad. Stalin was keen to advance further, but Zhukov and others persuaded Stalin that a defensive posture was more suitable at this stage of the war. The Russians were also fully aware of the German plans, as they had been receiving information from the Lucy spy ring. This reliable source was fed from Bletchley Park in England. The scientists working at this top-secret location had broken the secret German Enigma code at the start of the war, and had been watching developments very closely ever since. They passed information to the Soviets via an intricate web of contacts situated in Switzerland. Although the Russians never knew the true source of the information, they came to rely upon its accuracy. They were therefore given the dates of the planned German attacks in advance and began to prepare accordingly. massive defensive belts were constructed, with the sole purpose of the destruction of German armor and men. Zhukov, the master tactician, also gathered strong reserves that would be unleashed when the time was right. This well-prepared trap would be the launch pad for the defeat of Germany in the east. Georgi Zhukov gained his first military experience under the Tsarist army during World War I. He actually changed sides during the war and joined the communists during the revolution in 1917. Zhukov served in various positions after the war and became an early expert in the use of armor. He managed to escape the purges of 1937 that cost so many their lives. His first real success came against Japan at Khalkhin Gol during 1939, and he then played his part in the successful defense of Leningrad. He was given the responsibility for the defense of Stalingrad in late 1942, when he planned and executed the first major defeat of the German army. Zhukov was a quick-tempered man who intensely disliked those who failed in their duty. Konstantin Rokossovsky was one of the Soviet advisors during the Spanish Civil War. He was also caught up in the purges of 1937. He escaped death, but did spend a period in prison. He was called back into service to help in the defense of Moscow in 1941. And also had the control of the Don Front during the Stalingrad Battle. He was in command of the Central Front during the Battle of Kursk. Pavel Rotmistrov was also an early advocate of tank warfare. He first had command of the Russian 7th Tank Corps and was involved in the fighting around Rostov and Stalingrad, where he formed his tactical ideas. It was Rotmistrov who first suggested the use of complete armor-only formations. This tactic was adopted, and he subsequently gained command of the 5th Guards Tank Army. A very able commander, Rotmistrov had the appearance of a quiet schoolteacher, but the mind and determination of a brilliant military tactician. Ivan Konev, born in 1897, served the Tsar during the First World War as an NCO. By 1917, he had become a communist and joined the Russian Revolution, serving as a political commissar. He then joined the Red Army and graduated successfully from the Frunze Military Academy. In August 1941, he served in the Transcaucasian Military District inside the Smolensk sector. In October 1941, he became commander of the Kalinin Front and helped to resist the German drive towards Moscow. Konev made a name for himself as an aggressive and highly competent commander, regarded by many as second only to Zhukov. He was the perfect man to command the steppe front during the Kursk offensive. Kurt Zeitzler served as an infantryman during World War I and continued his military career during the interwar years. In 1934, he transferred to the newly created tank section, which was one of a number of changes brought in under Hitler. By 1939, he had risen to the rank of colonel, his forte being organization and mechanized warfare. He held various staff positions during the first 2 years of the war, and by 1942, he was serving in the West under von Rundstedt. He played a significant role in the Allied defeat at Dieppe during that year, bringing him to the attention of Hitler. A month after Dieppe, he was promoted to general and became the chief of staff. His approach to older generals sometimes caused him problems with fellow officers, for he always spoke his mind, even clashing with Hitler on a number of occasions. He tried in vain to make Hitler see sense at Stalingrad. It was Zeitzler who drew up the plans for the Kursk offensive and its pincer attacks. Although some of the other generals voiced their concerns, Zeitzler pushed enthusiastically for the plan, which was finally approved by Hitler. Its consequences would prove disastrous for Germany. Erich von Manstein, the commander of Army Group South, is acknowledged as one of the most able German commanders of the Second World War. His military experience dated back to World War I, where he fought on the Western and Eastern fronts. Before the end of the war, he had reached the rank of captain. By the time Hitler came to power in 1933, von Manstein was a lieutenant colonel with the German General Staff. Further promotions followed until the outbreak of World War II, when he held the rank of lieutenant general. Before the start of the war, he had been responsible for suggesting the use of the assault gun that was to become known as the Sturmgeschütz, a machine that was to play a significant part in Germany's conduct of the war. He was closely involved in planning the various opening campaigns. The successful plan for the attacks in the West in 1940 are also thought to be the brainchild of von Manstein, although Hitler later claimed them as his own. Von Manstein had a gift for determining the enemy's intentions and identifying their weaknesses. He held various field commands from the start of the war with Russia in 1941, and successes included the defeat of the fortress of Sevastopol. However, the longer the war in Russia dragged on, the more Hitler and von Manstein differed over its execution. Hitler was obsessed with holding positions to the last man, and von Manstein tried in vain to change Hitler's tactical reasoning. By the start of July 1943, von Manstein was in overall command of Army Group South, which played the major role in the execution of Plan Zitadel. Hermann Hoth, born on the 12th of April 1895, served in the First World War. He remained in the German army, and by 1936, Hoth was a divisional commander. He commanded the 15th Panzer Corps during the invasion of Poland, and on the 27th of October 1939, was awarded with the Ritterkreuz for his service. Hoth went on to lead the 15th Panzer Corps through the successful French campaign of 1940. He then led Panzer Group 3, later renamed the 3rd Panzer Army, towards Leningrad and on to Moscow, where he almost succeeded in his mission. By 1942, Hoth was commander of the 4th Panzer Army and in action at Stalingrad. His mission was to get the trapped 6th Army out of the city, but the task was virtually impossible, and he failed. Hoth and his 4th Panzer Army went on to be involved at the heart of fighting at Kursk. Army Group Center under von Kluger also played a significant role in the plans for Kursk. To the north of the salient, von Kluger's army group would serve in the 9th Army that would provide one of the two great pincers designed to snuff out the Soviet salient. Walther Model also gained his early experiences during World War I, attaining the rank of captain. Like von Manstein, he had served in the interwar German army in various staff and field postings, including a stint as a lecturer on tactics and history. He continued in various posts in the early stages of World War II, and by mid-1940 held the rank of lieutenant general when he was also given command of the 3rd Panzer Division. Although he was an infantryman through and through, he quickly made it his job to explore the potential of tank warfare. Model constantly visited the front lines and always took a keen interest in the welfare of his men. His division was involved in the Titanic encirclement at Kiev and also the attacks towards Moscow. Model firmly believed in the concept of lightning war, and his successes did not go unnoticed by Hitler. By the start of 1942, he was in command of the 9th Army with the rank of Colonel General he was given the task of attacking in the Rzhev sector in southern Russia. The bloody battles here would last for almost a year. By spring 1943, his 9th Army was well placed to take part in the Kursk offensive. Hitler knew just how vital the coming battle would be and placed a great deal of faith in the new tanks developed for the offensive. General Heinz Guderian had been recalled and appointed to a new position of Inspector General of the Armoured Forces, especially for the Kursk battle. The purges of 1937 upon the army by Stalin had left a weak and poorly led force. Around the start of 1941, however, the army was undergoing a reorganization. When the Germans launched their attack in June of that year, they caught the Red Army off guard. The initial advances by the Germans cut deep into the Russian rear areas. In many cases, the Germans found themselves advancing eastwards and also defending westwards as the retreating Russians caught up with them. There appeared to be no effective organization or control over the mass of Russian soldiers in the early stages. As the first winter set in, however, the first signs appeared that things were not going to go Hitler's way. Better adapted to the climate and countryside, the Russian army quickly launched their first offensive that almost succeeded in overrunning the German army. The main drawback for the Red Army was the constant interference by political commissars who instilled fear into every soldier. Often, commanders were reluctant to take key decisions without clear instructions from much higher up. This directly affected the course of the fighting and may have contributed to some of the Red Army's defeats. The Russian soldier was also dealing with new tactics being employed by the Germans. What was more, the Red Army suffered many problems of supply, and the loss of vital industrial regions and the relocation of factories further east hit production hard. As the war progressed, the Red Army became better equipped and more able to cope with the superior skills of the German army. The Red Army's sheer weight of numbers, of both men and materials, was beginning to turn the tide in their favor by mid-1943. The Russian soldier had the backup of plentiful tanks and planes, and they did not appear in the bewildering array of different types used by the German army. The most widely used battle tank was the T-34. This tank made its battlefield debut in 1941, soon after the Germans poured over the Russian border. The Germans had no prior knowledge of the T-34, and they quickly learned to respect it. The T-34's design, which remained largely unchanged throughout the war, was simple and crude, but highly practical. It had excellent sloping armor, which, although only 45 millimeters thick, increased its protective capabilities. It had wide tracks that were well suited to the Russian countryside and the worst of the Russian winter. The armaments on the version used at Kursk were a 76 millimeter dual-purpose main gun, backed up with three 7.62mm machine guns. It was powered by a very reliable diesel engine and gave a top speed of 33 miles per hour. It weighed around 26 tons and had a five-man crew. The downside was the poorly designed turret that had to be traversed by hand. It was also very cramped, with rudimentary radio communications. Fighting alongside the T-34 was the KV-1. This was a heavier tank, weighing in at over 43 tons, which also had a five-man crew. The reliable diesel engine produced a top speed of 22 miles per hour. The armour protection was 110 millimetres thick, and like the T-34, its main gun was a 76mm weapon, backed up with three 7.62mm machine guns. It carried more than adequate ammunition supplies and had excellent suspension. Unfortunately, it also had a poorly designed turret and complex gun sighting mechanism. The crews that manned them were poorly trained, and these faults conspired to ensure that the KV-1 would never have the impact of its more famous stablemate. Kursk is famed for its large tank battle, but equally as ferocious was the aerial war that raged overhead. Like their tank forces, the Russians used a few simple designs for their aircraft that were practical and produced in large numbers. The IL-2 was one of these. It would see a great deal of action around Kursk. Over 36,000 of these aircraft were manufactured before the end of the war. The IL-2 was a ground attack plane and was an excellent performer at low levels. Top speed was around 250 miles per hour. The main armaments were two 37mm cannons and two 7.62mm machine guns, plus one rear-facing machine gun for added protection. It could also carry up to 600 kilograms of bombs. As it was best suited to low-level attacks, the construction allowed for a certain amount of armor protection to be included. The main areas protected were the underside, cockpit, and fuel tanks. From its introduction in 1941, the plane was involved in most of the fighting on the Eastern Front. Although the Red Air Force pilots could not match the skills of the Luftwaffe aces, this plane and its pilots did play a significant part in the defeat of the Third Reich. The Nazi propaganda machine had described the Russians as subhuman. The German army advanced into Russia with the belief that they were up against an incapable army, poorly led and badly equipped. The first 6 months of the war produced evidence that this was indeed the case. However, as 1942 began, the Red Army started to show its true abilities. Its men were able to cope with the extreme weather fluctuations, sustaining themselves on meager rations and living off the land. They had excellent defensive skills, something that the Germans quickly learned to their cost. They also had simple but highly effective equipment that was designed for the punishing weather. The Russian Achilles heel was their poor leadership and fear of their political masters. The tactics employed paid no heed to the cost in human lives, and penal squads and summary executions were widely used in an attempt to gain objectives. The overriding motivation of many of the men was their love of Mother Russia. Despite all of the hardships and demands placed upon them, their resilience and determination would see them through to victory. The German army of World War II was arguably one of the most efficient the modern world has seen, superbly led by capable leaders such as Guderian, Rommel, Model and von Manstein. They achieved victory after victory in the first years of the war. The army was extremely professional and very aggressive. Expert training saw the Wehrmacht employ new and far-thinking tactics with devastating results. These tactics helped them defeat numerically superior enemy forces and secure almost impossible objectives. For 2 years, their combined tactics and training would take them from Poland to the shores of France and then on to the banks of the Volga at Stalingrad, defeating every enemy along the way. A major problem was that the Wehrmacht had to contend with incessant infighting at higher levels. This sometimes resulted in unclear objectives, most notably during the war with Russia. Without doubt, being led by a dictator such as Hitler, whose military experience and abilities were limited, also had its effect on the final outcome of the war. Masters at the art of counterattack and equally adept in attack or defense, the German army was, however, a worthy opponent to any foe. Despite an ever-decreasing supply of resources and multiplying difficulties, they remained resolute and focused on their tasks. The heavy defeat at Stalingrad had deeply affected them, and the fact that they quickly recovered and managed a stunning victory at Kharkov is evidence of their capabilities. Contrary to popular belief, by the start of July 1943, the German army was far from defeated. The arrival of the formidable T-34 onto the battlefield caused the Germans to revive some of their pre-war plans for heavier tanks. One of the results was arguably the best tank of World War II. The Panzer Mark V, or Panther, weighed in at 45 tons. It had a five-man crew protected by 120mm sloped armor. This tank was armed with a superb 75mm L-70 main gun with two 7.92mm MG-34 machine guns as backup. It could produce a top speed of 30 miles per hour. It was rushed through production to ensure that it was ready for the Kursk offensive. Hitler placed great hopes on the Panther and delayed the start of the battle to allow for its production. The early models were plagued with mechanical breakdowns that would have serious consequences for the troops at Kursk. But once the design problems were rectified, the Panther tank became an excellent weapon. The Panzer Mark VI, better known as the Tiger I, was designed to put the Germans ahead of the Russians in tank design. The result was a machine that weighed in at a huge 55 tons. Its five-man crew was well protected by 110mm thick armor. Unlike the Panther, the Tiger I had the more conventional flat-sided armor that wasn't as effective as sloped armor, but it was so thick that it was virtually impervious to any weapon on the battlefield. The Tiger's main armament was the phenomenal 88mm gun, capable of destroying anything it came across at ranges up to 2,000 meters. The close support weapons were the standard two MG-34 machine guns. The 21-liter engine produced a top speed of 24 miles per hour. The first large-scale deployment of the Tiger tank was at Kursk, when approximately 100 were used. They were placed mainly with the elite formations of the Waffen-SS and the Gross-Deutschland division. The Tiger would quickly earn a fearsome reputation and would play its part in helping the Germans smash through the extensive Russian defenses during Zitadel. This heavy tank destroyer appeared after Ferdinand Porsche's design for the Tiger I was turned down. The Porsche firm was so confident that their design would be chosen that they had begun to produce their version, but production stopped when Hitler's decision was announced. Rather than waste those that had already been constructed, they were put to use. Hitler had also ordered the design of an assault weapon that could mount the longer L-71 version of the 88mm gun. The Tiger I was incapable of doing this, so the 90 Porsche chassis were chosen. The resulting weapon, Ferdinand, weighed in at a colossal 68 tons and required a crew of 6 men. The armor protection was provided by 200 millimeters of steel plate. The top speed was only 12 miles per hour. The Ferdinand was rushed through the production stage with very serious consequences for the crews manning them and the infantry who were relying on them during the fighting. During the design stage, the need for a close-quarter defense machine gun was overlooked. The suspension was not adequate to support the weight of the tank destroyer, with the result that the vehicle easily bogged down. These flaws helped to ensure that the battlefield debut of the Ferdinand was a failure. 40 of the 80 machines which took part in the battle were lost to the enemy within the first 3 days. One other important new development made its arrival known during the Kursk offensive. The Stuka dive bomber had played its part in the early victories of the German army. It became an excellent psychological weapon and instilled terror again and again. However, as the war progressed, this slow aircraft was quickly outclassed by the faster enemy planes. The Stuka had undergone a few modifications since its first introduction in 1937. The standard version, available in early 1943, could reach a speed of around 255 miles per hour. The armament was two 7.92mm machine guns situated on the wings, with a further rear-facing machine gun. It could carry up to 1,800 kilograms of bombs. The Stuka was widely used, and during March of 1943, testing took place on a new anti-tank version. Two 37mm flak cannons were fitted to the underside of the plane in place of the bomb load. It was soon found that this weapon was very accurate and effective for destroying enemy tanks, although the pilots had to go into a shallow dive and get within close range of their targets, making them vulnerable to anti-aircraft fire. The use of this new weapon became the responsibility of some of Germany's best-known pilots, among them Hans Ulrich Rudel, an accomplished airman who held Germany's highest award for bravery. Rudel, and the pilots like him, put the new tank-busting variant to good use and quickly chalked up a high number of enemy tank kills. The restrictions imposed on Germany after the First World War included a limit on the size of her army. Although painful for the Germans, this restriction would have noticeable benefits when war finally broke out again. The selection process was rigorous, and only the best candidates were chosen. As the political situation changed and the army expanded, these carefully chosen men moved up the ranks and passed their skills down to many others. Another result of the interwar restrictions was that even the most junior soldier was trained to take the place of his superior. With some brilliant tacticians and military minds leading them, and supplied with good equipment, the German army of 1939 was a truly formidable opponent. Unleashed into Poland in September of that year, the skills learned were put to good use. Quick, decisive campaigns followed, one after the other, over the next 18 months. The average German soldier that crossed the Russian border in June 1941 was a well-trained, battle-experienced, and very capable man. Determined and professional, the German soldier of World War II would prove his ability again and again. April 1943 saw the German army in desperate need of recuperation after their recent victory at Kharkov. The Russian army was also in danger of outrunning its own extended supply lines. These two factors resulted in a period of relative quiet over the Kursk region. But as German intentions became clear, the Russians began an intensive program of defensive measures that were designed to trap and blunt the German armor. Thousands of anti-tank guns were built into defensive lines in great depth, and millions of anti-tank mines were laid. Both sides prepared for the coming clash throughout May and June 1943. Expectations were high. Both believed that they could achieve a decisive victory, but the commanders of both sides were apprehensive. They could sense the importance of the forthcoming clash and could see how its outcome would affect the future course of the war. The armies facing each other in the Kursk salient in the late spring of 1943 knew the vital importance of victory in the coming battle. The halting of the Russian offensive in March had brought a lull to the southern sector of the Russian front, an area that had seen horrific and savage fighting for more than six blood-soaked months. As the German intention to attack became clear, an intense period of preparation began for the two opposing armies. The halting of the German advances at Stalingrad seriously affected German morale. But the stunning victory in the face of defeat at Kharkov in March 1943 helped to restore faith in the task at hand. The Russians were keen to make the most of their Stalingrad victory and were confident that they were finally starting to defeat the German forces. Their plans suffered a setback at Kharkov. And after this intensive battle, both sides drew their breath and prepared for the next phase of the struggle. The lull that descended over this region allowed the plans to be drawn up and the preparations to begin. Neither the Russians nor the Germans had infinite resources, and it was imperative that one side or the other secured a decisive victory. Hitler and Stalin, Zhukov and Manstein knew how critical the situation was, and they began to put their plans into action. The brilliant tactician Zhukov commanded the Russians. He wasted no time in taking the measures needed to defeat the Germans. After all, he was familiar with the tactics employed by the invaders and had been instrumental in their biggest setbacks to date. As a defensive strategy had been decided upon, the first steps were to prepare defensive positions from which the Red Army would be able to halt and destroy the German forces. The only way that this would be possible for the overstretched Red Army of 1943 would be by enlisting the help of the civilian population. In the now secure rear areas, the repair of installations damaged or destroyed in the towns recently recaptured began in earnest. With a focus on the need to move vast supplies, feverish work on bridges, road and rail networks was undertaken. The main rail line into Kursk from the east was a hive of activity. Closer to the front line, work also began on the vast defensive belts that were later to entrap the Germans. In all, the Russians prepared a total of 5 main defensive lines. The first 2 lines ran around the perimeter of the pocket to a depth of around 10 to 12 miles and were situated close to each other. The remaining lines were spaced apart and ran to a depth of over 150 miles in total. Zhukov was clearly taking no chances. Within these defensive lines, construction began on individual positions that were to blunt the expected strong German armored attacks. Hundreds of thousands of anti-tank and anti-personnel mines were sent to the area. Cheap, easy to manufacture, but highly effective, these devices were planted in huge quantities. Estimates suggest a figure of up to 5,000 mines per mile of front. Other tried and tested measures, such as anti-tank ditches and barbed wire, were also widely employed. The intention was to draw in, hold up, and then destroy the attacker. Overall, it was an excellent demonstration of what could be achieved by the effective use of the engineering skills and materials at hand. Although the Citadel plan was approved in early May, the start date was continually delayed. Hitler's desire to leave no room for error saw him postpone again and again. Various factors caused these delays. One was the production of the new Panther tanks. These delays only helped the preparations of the Russian defences that were very apparent to the German reconnaissance aircraft that flew over and photographed the area countless times. All the while, the highly efficient Lucy spy ring continued to feed the Soviets with accurate information, telling the Soviets exactly where and when the Germans would strike. The aerial phase of the coming battle was to assume an importance almost equal to the fighting on land. The number of aircraft that did battle was vast, with around 2,000 planes on the German side, lined up against almost 3,000 on the Russian. The Russian Air Force had improved steadily since the 1941 German invasion, and they were, by this stage of the war, a well-equipped and well-organized force. They had also managed to gain a vital numerical superiority over the Luftwaffe. In the run-up to the battle, the Luftwaffe flew many aerial missions. During June, they destroyed over 300 Russian planes by various means. Their aim was to secure the Orel sector. As the battle got underway, the Luftwaffe became heavily involved. On the 9th of July, the 1st Air Division actually attacked an armoured Russian spearhead near the main Orel to Bryansk railway, and they managed to blunt this potentially dangerous development. When they flew away at the end of the day, hundreds of Soviet tanks lay shattered or in flames. In the south also, the Luftwaffe assisted in the advance of the Panzer forces, helping to avoid catastrophe on more than one occasion. For Kursk, four main Russian air armies were available. The 16th Air Army was responsible for the northern sector of the pocket, and the 2nd Air Army provided cover in the south. Nearby was the 17th Air Army, with the 15th Air Army situated further back. The number of planes available to the Russians was evenly split three ways. Approximately 1,000 bombers, 1,000 ground attack, and 1,000 fighter planes were available for the coming clash. Facing the Russian pilots were two German air groups. Luftflotte 6 was situated with Model's forces of Army Group Center in the north, whilst Luftflotte 4 was placed near Hoth's 4th Army in the south. The disposition of the German air groups in this area produced a ratio of two bombers to one fighter. Like all parts of the German armed services, the Luftwaffe had suffered massive losses over the previous 2 years. The numerical superiority enjoyed by the Russians also severely hampered German attempts to retain control. Underneath their protective air umbrellas, the soldiers and tank crews on the ground busied themselves with their preparation. Zhukov poured huge amounts of men and materials into the area, and great emphasis was placed on the use of artillery. No fewer than 20,000 artillery pieces would be used during this coming battle. Like mines, artillery pieces were easier and cheaper to manufacture than tanks. The numbers of Russian soldiers sent into the Kursk salient area exceeded 1.3 million. In the north of the salient was the Central Front, under the command of General Rokossovsky. In the south was the Voronezh Front, commanded by General Vatutin. In reserve, behind the salient, was the Steppe Front, under the control of General Konev. The bulk of the Soviet armor was placed incorrectly in the northern sector of the salient, as the Russians felt this area would receive the hardest blow. This would cause problems for Zhukov in the early stages of the battle. Some 900,000 German soldiers were committed to the Battle of Kursk. Not only were they outnumbered from the outset, they also bore the burden of having to take the offensive. The German forces were positioned under the personal supervision of Hitler. From the Army Group Center, the 9th Army in the north, under Field Marshal Model, had five corps to call upon. In the sector of Army Group South, was General Hoth's 4th Panzer Army. To Hoth's right were Army Detachment Kempf. The deposition of the new panzers reflected the emphasis of the south in the German attack plan. Around 90 Tigers and just over 100 of the new Panther tanks were to be found in this region. This was by far the biggest gathering of the new generation of German tanks, and much was expected of them. The plan of attack was simple. It was to smash through the Russian defences and meet behind Kursk. But one important factor was missing: an effective reserve force. This was no longer possible for the Germans at this stage in the war. Although the Russians were receiving intelligence information from the Lucy spy ring, this was at a higher level and did not give enough detail on the front line changes that occurred. The sheer sizes of the opposing armies involved made it impossible to conceal them effectively. The increasing aerial armada was put to good use as extensive reconnaissance from the air was carried out. The Germans actually commented that they had photographed every piece of the intended battlefield area in the run-up to the start date. The main defensive measures used by the Russians could be seen from the air, but the more detailed gun emplacements were still expertly hidden. A number of dummy positions were constructed as a time-tested means of fooling the enemy. German confidence was running high, and nothing they saw altered their decision to attack. The Russians also used information gathered from captured prisoners. Special raids were carried out in order to snatch prisoners for this purpose. The Germans too used this type of information gathering. Before any major operation, the radio traffic passing among the enemy units increased dramatically, with specially trained troops intercepting it. It is impossible to know fully the intentions of the enemy, but through the use of these various methods, a clearer picture of their plans can be determined. By the 5th of July 1943, everything was in place. The vast quantities of men, tanks, ammunition, guns and planes were in their positions. Every person, from the infantry right up to army group commanders, was in a state of anticipation and excitement. The reliable information provided to the Soviet sources revealed the date and the time of the German attack, which was further confirmed by captured German prisoners. Zhukov therefore planned a huge preemptive artillery strike against the German positions. The aim was to catch the Germans as they began to assemble, and thus deliver a severe psychological blow to the enemy, even before a shot had been fired. In the central front area, the Russian artillery opened up, and for almost an hour, hundreds of guns fired towards the suspected enemy emplacements. Model's forces quickly recovered from the Russian barrage and began to reply with their own artillery attack. And over the northern part of the Kursk salient, the noises, flashes of light, death and destruction reached a ferocious intensity. The actual losses suffered by both sides were not as high as expected. The difficulty was that the artillery strike on the enemy was made during the hours of darkness, and positions were not known in detail. The effects of the strike could not be seen from the ground, nor, more importantly, from the air, which meant that correction action could not be taken. Zhukov had taken a gamble by ordering the artillery strike. And it was soon discovered that the results fell short of expectations. As this duel between the two sides continued, elements of Luftflotte 6 arrived to begin ferocious attacks on suspected Russian positions. Amid the thunder of exploding shells, the German infantry and panzers moved out against the enemy lines. Almost immediately, Model's troops ran into the well-prepared Russian killing zones. The snail-like pace of the German attack helped the Russians to inflict losses on the Germans with ease. Model was fast discovering that the Russian forces presented a virtual brick wall in the path of his advance. He urged his troops forward to try and discover a weak point in the Russian lines. The German plan had given the main Orel to Kursk railway as the advance line, and the town of Poniri as the first major objective. But this was changed as the strength of the defences became clear, and the main emphasis of the attack was shifted towards Olkhovatka, further west. The first day's fighting had achieved an advance of only 6 miles. The push towards Olkhovatka continued on the second day of battle. The enemy defences near Ponry on the left flank were too strong for the Germans to achieve a breakthrough, and Model had to push on in any direction possible. Russian reserves had been moved towards this area during the night of the 5th of July, and they began to commit themselves to the battle on the 6th. As daylight broke over this northern area, both sides locked together in a bitter struggle to gain their separate objectives. The Tiger tanks of the 505th Schwere Abteilung were fully committed to the battle by the anxious Germans. They slammed into the Soviet defences and the increasing number of Soviet forces moving into the area, but made limited headway as the defensive measures employed by Rosikovsky had been well planned. They had to cope with the infantry's T-34s, anti-tank guns and anti-tank rifles. Slowly, the Tiger tank losses mounted, reducing their effectiveness and, more importantly, their influence on the battle. Russian aircraft had also begun to make their presence felt by attacking German targets. German and Russian pilots duelled for control of the skies over the northern sector. The Soviet defensive wall in the northern part of the salient slowed Model's advance to a mere crawl. These delays kept his forces contained within a relatively small area, thus helping the Russians to plan effective countermeasures. But the Russians did not have it all their own way. The Germans fought well. Luftflotte 6 flew countless sorties over the northern part of the battlefield and helped to inflict losses on the ever-increasing number of Russian forces moving into the area. The German troops on the ground moved slowly towards Olkhovatka as the forces of Rokossovsky rushed forward to intercept them. Model's forces managed to take control of Ponry on the left flank and also the town of Teploy on the right flank. These advances represented the furthest points reached in the northern sector by the forces of Model's 9th Army. The Russian defences and weight of numbers presented Model with a barrier that he failed to penetrate. It was now apparent that the forces available to Model were insufficient to smash through the Russian lines. The new Ferdinands had also proved inadequate during the fight. A design flaw had failed to fit the new heavy tank destroyers with any close support machine guns. As they became separated from the supporting infantry and bogged down in the Russian defences, enemy troops were able to close right up alongside them and easily disable them. The Tigers were also not suited to close-quarter fighting, where the superior guns could not be used effectively. Ferocious battles raged over the area as both sides sought an advantage, but none was gained. The area descended into stalemate over the next few days. The total distance covered by Model's 9th Army in the northern sector of the Kursk salient during Zitadel was around 12 miles. The capture of Kursk, if achieved, would not be sufficient to defeat the Russian forces in this area. Model's forces were contained in an area that was around 40 miles short of their target. If Kursk were to fall to Hoth's men, a gap of this size would allow the Russians to pour reinforcements into the salient at their will. Powerless to influence the battle any further, Model contented himself with holding on to the areas already captured. The German forces in the north had been stalled. But the real focus of this most historic of battles was in the south. In the southern sector, Hoth's 4th Army enjoyed the largest concentration of tanks under the control of the best divisions in the German order of battle. The 4th of July 1943 saw a different start for Hoth's 4th Panzer Army. Hoth decided to jump ahead of the planned start date of the attack. Aircraft from Luftflotte 4 began the attack on the enemy-held positions, followed by a German artillery barrage. As this barrage lifted, the infantry and tanks moved forward to engage the enemy, and throughout the day, the front line was pushed back in favour of the Germans. The fighting was heavy, and in some areas, the objectives given were not taken until the hours of darkness. This was the first in a series of setbacks for the Russians in the south. These setbacks accumulated steadily over the next few days. The 5th of July began with the 4th Panzer Army in control of the vital high ground. Hoth was keen to get things moving, and he began the next stage of his plan. He ordered a change to the planned route of advance so that the main advance would be moving more to the left. This change was not apparent to Vatutin or Stavka, as Hoth had made his decision without consulting higher command, and therefore Lucy did not pick it up. The German artillery in the southern region was therefore able to deliver its attack first. As this was happening, the Russian Air Force was on its way to attack the German airfields. But the Germans detected their approach and quickly sent their own planes to intercept. An intensive air battle ensued over the southern part of the salient as the German fighters tore into the Russian formations. At the end of the engagement, the Luftwaffe of Luftflotte 4 was in control of the air. Against this backdrop, the panzers moved forward. The removal of the aerial threat and the fact that the Russian ground units were expecting a different focus of attack allowed the German tanks to smash through the defensive positions. The Russians realized that they were wrong in their estimates of the disposition of the enemy armored foundations, and that they were about to bear the brunt of the strong enemy forces lined up in front of them. The Germans were using a new tactic based on the new heavy tanks, which was known as a panzer keel or armored wedge. This tactic placed the heavier Tigers at the tip of the wedge, with the Panthers forming the outer edges. The weaker Panzer IVs and Panzer IIIs were placed in the center of the wedge. The Russians were not prepared for the rate of the German advances. Their defensive positions did inflict losses on the Germans, and they held fast in many areas. By the end of the first day, some of the 4th Panzer Army had advanced up to 15 miles. This was more than Model's forces managed in 8 days. It could have been much further, but late changes of orders meant that insufficient time had been left for mine clearance. An enraged General Guderian watched as many of his priceless German Tigers were needlessly destroyed by mines. By the end of the third day's fighting, the Germans had made an advance of around 20 miles. This was beginning to cause concern for the Russians, so much that they ordered the 5th Guards Tank Army and other reserves to be moved from the steppe front and into the area of Prokhorovka. The main defensive sector for the Russians was the town of Oboyan, 35 miles south of Kursk. The Russians had placed strong forces in this area, as they were aware of the importance of holding this town. This was the left flank of Hoth's attack plan. The strength of the defenses around this area became clear to the Germans, and Hoth decided to switch the emphasis of his attacks to the east. The Sel River, which runs between Oboyan and Prokhorovka, became the focus for the SS Totenkopf division. The SS Liebstandarte division would take the center, and the SS division Das Reich would hold the right flank. By the time they got to Prokhorovka, the Russians had already placed their reserves. The ferociousness of the preceding day's fighting was about to be dwarfed in scale and intensity. The right flank of the German advance in the south consisted of Army Detachment Kempf. To start with, they would advance directly east, below the town of Belgorod. They would then change direction and advance north to link with the 2nd SS Panzer Corps. The first obstacle for Kempf's men was the Donets River, which ran through Belgorod and along the front of the planned route of advance. Kempf's men fought well, and by the end of the first day, they had crossed the river and set up a defensive horseshoe position. Their advance continued over the next few days, despite increasing resistance. Hoth's plan envisaged a link-up between his men and Kempf's men around Prokhorovka, a move that would have put the Germans in a very strong position. The drawback to this plan was that by the 11th of July, Kempf's forces were situated roughly 12 miles south of the intended target. They still had a lot of ground to cover, and the possibility loomed that they would be unable to resist the struggle towards Prokhorovka. The upper reaches of the Donets River also stretched towards Prokhorovka, which meant that Kempf's men would have to force a crossing of this river a second time. The task ahead of them was difficult, but this did not prevent them from continuing with their attempts. As the decisive battle raged around Prokhorovka on the 12th of July, Kempf's men were positioned about 10 miles short of this objective. They did not actually link up with the 2nd SS Panzer Corps until 3 days later. This was too late to assist in the decisive battle, and too late to change Hitler's decision regarding the future course of this engagement. The two armies were now on a direct collision course. The Russians knew of the armor-led force bearing down on them and were ready to meet and destroy the threat. The Germans, however, were not aware of the strong enemy concentration of tanks that was facing them. The Russians had managed to place around 850 of their tanks in the surrounding area. The Germans had around 300 usable tanks advancing directly in the battle zone, with a further 230 fighting to their left. Hoth felt that he had inflicted serious losses on the Russians and was expecting a quick victory that would open the way for a rapid advance. The Russians knew it was vital to hold on and move their important reserves from Konev's area to Prokhorovka. The dawn of the 12th of July would see an unprecedented clash of tanks that would decide the outcome of the whole campaign. Before the tanks played their part, the customary aerial attacks began, and the German planes swooped in on enemy positions. The next stage was an artillery attack, delivered by the Russians towards the German lines. And while the shells rained down, the Russian tanks broke out of their positions. This move coincided with the start of the German tank advance. Neither side would have foreseen or planned what occurred next. The two tank advances smashed into each other, head-on. From this point onwards, all control of the battle disappeared, and total confusion set in. The planes and artillery that would have usually joined in the battle were rendered impotent, as the close proximity of the machines and the swirling dust clouds made it impossible to tell friend or foe apart. Rather than risk destroying their own machines, the air forces of both sides were left with no option other than to let the tanks get on with the battle. The The German Tigers and Panthers could not make effective use of their long-range guns, and to their horror, they discovered that the Russian tanks were able to penetrate their armor at this short range. Another tactic employed by the numerically superior Russians was to drive straight into the German tanks and ram them, completely destroying both machines and their occupants. The Soviets knew that their tanks could always be replaced, but for the Germans, at the limit of their capability, each Tiger lost was lost forever. As the Germans desperately sought a line of advance through the storm, the failure of Kempf's forces to reach the battle area was having deadly consequences for them. The battle ebbed and flowed all day, with no decisive outcome. At some stages during the day, the Germans did appear to be on the verge of a breakthrough. But the Russians sent new reserves into the line and succeeded in holding the Germans. As darkness fell, the battlefield grew quiet. Both sides were exhausted and made the most of the enforced lull. No time was wasted, however, on preparing to resume the next day. The short climax to the Kursk offensive resulted in the end of Germany's successes in the east. The 12-hour battle had drawn in and chewed up the best divisions that Hitler possessed. Tanks and men had been lost at a steady rate since the start of the offensive. And by the time they reached Prokhorovka, they were in no fit state to sustain a heavy attack. The Germans had maintained fairly constant numbers of tanks in the field through the skill of the tank repair shops. But the size of the enemy forces facing them and their lack of a reserve prevented any further advances. The Russians had lost over 400 tanks in the battle thus far and were themselves left in a vulnerable position by the end of the day. They expected the Germans to begin the following day with a sizable attack. During the night of July the 12th, the Russians and Germans recovered what vehicles they could from the battlefield and readied them for use again. The 13th, however, would not see the Germans resume their attempts to advance. It would actually see a direct Führer order calling off the Zitadelle offensive. The order to call off the attacks surprised von Manstein, as he could sense the cracks beginning to appear in the Russian defenses. One of the main reasons for the postponement of Zitadel had nothing to do with the Russian front. It was the recent Allied invasion of Sicily, which took place on the 10th of July. Hitler, who was always conscious of the changing political situation, could see the dangers that this development presented. He simply needed to pull troops out of the line and send them to meet this new threat. One of the formations ordered out was the 2nd SS Panzer Corps. The moves did not begin straight away, however, and when they did, only some divisions were moved. This new development meant that Hitler was faced with the one situation he had tried to avoid from the moment his troops had crossed the Polish border in 1939. A war on two fronts. From this point onwards, the war would not be fought on Hitler's terms, but on the terms of his enemies, who were growing stronger with each passing day. From now on, they decided where the next battle would be fought. This left Hitler powerless to do anything but move his decreasing forces to meet each new threat. On the 13th of July, the Russians began their probing attacks in the sector north of Orel. By this stage, Model's forces had created their own bulge that was flanked on both sides by strong Russian formations. These probing attacks gained momentum, and by the 16th of July, had turned into an all-out counter-offensive. The Germans had not prepared any defensive positions in these areas and could not hold the Russian attacks. The Russians were fighting over familiar ground and had the benefit of being able to use their rested formations from the Bryansk and Western fronts. They steadily pushed Model's 9th Army back in the north to the Hagen defensive line. And by the end of the first week in August 1943, the town of Orel was back in Russian hands. Around this time, the counteroffensive in the southern area was gaining momentum and also regaining lost ground at a steady pace. By the end of August, Kharkov would come under Russian control for the final time. The Russian advances, although steady, were not easy. The Germans defended resolutely and exacted a heavy toll on the advancing enemy troops. The Russians, however, could replace their losses and relentlessly pushed ahead. They had scented victory, and the ultimate defeat of the enemy was becoming an ever-increasing possibility. One of the main purposes of the Citadel offensive was to straighten the line for the Germans and free up much-needed troops for the Allied invasion expected in the near future. By the end of August 1943, the front line had been straightened. The only problem for Hitler was that it was 100 miles in favor of Stalin's troops. Further key divisions had been taken out of the area in an attempt to deal with the situations developing elsewhere. The Russian front had become little more than a holding action, where each new threat had to be countered in the best way possible. The rotten edifice that Hitler spoke of in his planning of Barbarossa was a fantasy. The reality was a strong and determined country that would swallow millions of his troops in the titanic battles that raged from June 1941 to May 1945. Battles that ended at the very doors of Hitler's bunker in Berlin. Hitler had placed everything on one last throw of the dice. The gamble would ultimately mean the end for his beloved fatherland and divide the rest of Europe for 45 years.